My castaway this week is a singer who is very much a child of his time. When he first came to our attention 7 years ago, it was as much for his makeup and unusual clothes as anything else. Since then, however, he's established himself as a continually popular entertainer, proving that his talent, like his disguise, is more enduring than many people thought. But the way to the top has not always been easy. He's had to conquer an addiction to drugs. Some of his friends have lost that battle and died. And his private life has been the subject of much public speculation. He is, of course, Boy George. And Boy George, whatever else he is or is not, is a survivor, I think.
Well, I don't know about that, but it's nice to think so. Whatever happens to you in your life, if you go through sort of tragedies, I think that they do, in a lot of ways, make you a better person. You learn from your mistakes. I mean, I'm a much better person in a lot of ways than I was when I was a teenager. I'm a lot more stable. You know, I tend to sort of think more now than I did before. So I suppose, in a way, it's a good thing.
But one's tempted to believe that there is somebody up there looking after you.
Don't know, really. I think it's more to do with the people around you. You know, I think that I have good friends. I have a good family. And not to get too sentimental, but I think I have people around me that care about me, and I think that's one of the things that you need.
We'll talk about your life and its highs and its lows in a moment, but let's first, if we may, explore the concept of Boy George alone on a desert island. It doesn't strike me as being quite your habitat.
Well, I haven't been on a desert island. I've been to, like, tropical places, and I've enjoyed it, but I really do prefer the company of people. I mean, I think one of the things that would drive me really crazy would be not seeing people, because that's really how I've always based my life. You know, I need company of other people. I find it very difficult to be on my own. So I don't know how I deal with being on a desert island with a bunch of coconuts and a palm tree.
And how would you deal with the sun and the sand and living off the land and all that?
Well, I think a lot of people like to think they'd be able to cope with it, but I don't know. I think I'm very much a modern person in the sense that I like all the amenities of life. I don't know if I'd be able to cope with it, really, to be quite honest.
How have you chosen your records? What are they?
I've really chosen records that make me feel good. I think music should either make you feel happy or sad, or both. And I tend to choose records that are immediate. And also, I'm very much into characters. Somebody doesn't necessarily have to be a good singer, although I have chosen some people that are fine singers here, but I just choose people for their character and just that they do something to me when I hear the record. I mean, in particular, the first one, which is Marlene Dietrich, Blowing in the Wind. It's a Bob Dylan song, but I think this is a far superior version. I mean, a lot of people are going to gag when they hear me say that, but this just makes me feel really happy. The music is so quirky. I love this one.
How many times must the cannonballs fly before they're forever banned? The answer, my friend, is blown in the wind. The answer is blown in the wind.
Marlene Dietrich singing Blowing in the Wind. You are, George, as I was saying at the beginning, one of the durable figures of the 80s pop scene. It's strange, therefore, to think that when you first appeared, people laughed at you in that mask-like makeup and effeminate clothes.
Well, when I was a teenager, I was heavily influenced by people that I would term as very colourful, flamboyant, people like Mark Bolan. I mean, I used to have posters of Mark Bolan smothered all over my wall. I was constantly having them ripped down by my grandmother. You can't like him, he's a puff. And things like that, and David Bowie was the other one. So I think my reasons for wanting to be an entertainer, and I use that word quite widely, is that I wanted to be like them, I suppose. I mean, when I remember watching David Bowie performing Starman on Top of the Pops, and I was sitting there with a big smile from ear to ear, and my mother was going, oh, it's disgusting, it's disgusting. So, I mean, I think it's just something that you accept. You know?
Yes, but it must have taken guts in your case. I mean, other people stand up and do strange things, but there you were, a man, standing up, heavily coated in makeup, and, as I say, wearing very effeminate clothes. You must have known it would appeal, or you must have been deeply ambitious.
Actually, you know, I didn't know it would appeal at all. For a long time before the band ever took off, before I entered music, I was dressing up, walking around London, you know. England is one of those countries where you can actually be a star without doing very much, which is great, I think, in a lot of ways.
And did you sense, though, even then, that you might be going to be famous?
Well, when I met my manager, once I got friendly with him, he said, you know, if you can be like you are with me on your own, in public, people will like you. Because I had this big thing about people not liking me. I think one of the things about me is that I've always wanted to be liked, which is, I think, is one of the reasons why I get very defensive sometimes, because if I think people are having a go at me, then I get defensive. But I've always just wanted to be liked by everybody. I know that sounds really pathetic, but it's true. I just try and be myself. I just try and be George, and if people like that, they like it. I mean, a lot of people still don't like me, but, you know, there you go.
But you and your set had been sort of dressing up in various costumes, I mean, as Boadicea one minute and a nun the next, huh? Where did you hang out? Where was it all happening?
Well, I once went as Boadicea to the changing of the guards once, one morning really early. I just decided it would be a good idea, so we left our squat and trotted off down to Buckingham Palace and spent about 2 hours being photographed by Japanese people. I'd love to see some of those pictures. We just used to go to nightclubs, really, and it was a good way of getting in free everywhere, because people really didn't know what they were dealing with. You know, you walked into a premiere, you just walked in and sort of acted like you were meant to be there. I suppose it was a very kind of like hedonistic existence, you know, sort of partying all the time. But that's the kind of thing you want to do when you're sort of 17, 15, 16.
And then Marilyn turned up at this squat. Marilyn being a true transvestite, a man dressed up as a woman, not just you, as you were, taking on the trappings of a female. And together, I mean, you went about together, didn't you? You
must well, he was a lot more convincing than I was, you see.
You can say that,
you
again.
Know, he was, you know. I mean, I was sort of, I don't know, really, I was more into sort of, I suppose, the shock tactics of it, if you like. Marilyn was definitely into sort of people actually thinking he was female, which is quite a trip. But where is he now?
Where is he now?
I think he's in LA, actually.
Let's have your second record, shall we?
Okay, this is It Must Be Love by Madness, who I think are one of the best groups this decade.
And I never thought I'd feel this way, the way I feel about you. As soon as I wake up, every night, every day, I know that it's you I need to take the blues away. It must be love.
It Must Be Love, sung by Madness. Can we, George, hear something about your early life now? You were born 27 years ago of Irish parents in southeast London. A big family it was.
Yeah, six kids.
All brothers?
I think I've got four brothers and one sister.
You sure?
Yeah, definitely.
Close-knit?
Yes and no. When you come from a big family, you're constantly fighting for attention and I think it's very difficult. I mean, I think a relationship between two people is hard enough. So a relationship between eight must be hell, as you can imagine. So, but my parents had quite a tough life when we were kids. My father worked all the time. I mean, they didn't really have much leisure time.
And your mum nearly lost you under a car one day, is that right?
Well, it wasn't quite like that. When I was about 15, I had a very, very bad romance. And I got completely drunk, broke into the drinks cabinet, and drank a whole bottle of whiskey and ran off into the night and sort of ended up in Welling High Street in the middle of the road. And it was brought back, I think, by some really nice lady. I've never seen her since. I'd like to see her again. She sort of took me home. I managed to mumble where I came from. Took me home. I actually haven't drunk whiskey since then. I can't stand the smell of it. It always reminds me of being really drunk.
But you were not a success at school. There's this wonderful phrase, I think your headmaster's responsible for, your ex-headmaster is responsible for it, isn't it, that your school career was unblemished by achievement?
Well, it depends, really. I mean, I was very popular at school, with the girls, anyway, and some of the teachers liked me. My drama teacher loved me, and my art teacher liked me too. But, I mean, the rest of it I found very frustrating. I think school is a very unnatural thing to do. You know, when in your life are you forced to sit in a room with 40 people that you've got nothing in common with? It's a totally alien situation to be in. I think once you learn to read and write and a little bit of maths, you know, sign a cheque, I think then it's time to leave. I'm not really a school person. I mean, I think it's obviously necessary, but it didn't work for me.
You were expelled in the end?
Yeah, I was.
What for?
I came into school really late, and when you came into school late in my school, you had to stand on... We had this big concourse which had black and white squares, and you had to stand on a black square. And you had to stand there for half an hour with your hands behind your back, as straight as possible. And then the headmaster would come up the staircase from the assembly room. He used to wear this big, long Batman cape with like 1,000 pleats on it and a tassel. very stylish man. He'd come up and he would sort of walk around you, looking up and down at you and sort of looking at your clothes and basically making you feel very degraded. This sounds very sad, doesn't it? And then he would choose who he was going to whack that morning. I'd been off school, I'd just had my hair dyed bright orange, and I don't think he liked that very much. So he kind of chose to whack me, and we ended up having this big fight. And I said, well, I'm not taking the cane, you know, basically, forget it. So he said, well, you're leaving the school. And I said, fine, wonderful. And I was out the door as quick as you could say, you know, jumping jack flash. And that was it. It was the end of my school career, really.
You were 15?
Just, yeah.
Let's have your next record.
This is by Gladys Knight and the Pips. It's called If I Were Your Woman. There's no particular reason for this choice. I just wanted to choose a Gladys Knight record because she's one of my... I think she is my favourite female singer since I was a teenager.
You'd have no other woman. You'd be weak as a lamb if you had the strength to walk out that door. My love would overrule my sense, and I'd call you back for more if I were your woman.
If I Were Your Woman by Gladys Knight and the Pips. They're all very romantic, these records of yours, George.
Yeah, I'm a sucker for romance, I'm afraid.
So when did you hit it big? How did it happen?
I think the biggest year was 1983 with Karma Chameleon.
Your first album sold 4 million around the world. The second sold 10 million, I think. How did you take to fame? Did you just put it on easily?
Like a duck to water. No, really, I don't know. It was all a bit bewildering, really. It was a bit kind of like, there was a little bit of arrogance and a little bit of confusion. I think a little bit of everything, really. It was like, what's happening? But, you know, you don't question success. You just go with it, you know, you're just like, OK.
And you had a natural flair anyway for publicity, didn't you? I mean, you enjoyed it.
Well, I think everybody does when it's good publicity.
But what I mean is you're a natural flirt in that sense, that you will happily say something outrageous because you know it will get into the papers or...
Well,
I
do that anyway. I mean, I've always done that. Even when I was a kid, you know, I would say things to my parents that I knew would annoy them. So I think it was a kind of natural thing. I think now, more than ever, I'm probably really guarded about what I say. Not because I don't want to say it, because I still feel exactly the same way, and I still feel and think the same things. And I think that you realise, for instance, there were people in the heyday of Culture Club, at the newspapers, that I was really friendly with. I mean, I drank with them and had tea with them, whatever, you know. And then when it all started to go wrong, they were all as vicious as they possibly could be, which really did surprise me. That may sound really naive, but it made me think, wow, I'm really stupid. Of course, I'm not really stupid, but, I mean, I am in a lot of ways naive in that sense, because I think everybody is a good person until proved otherwise.
Do you feel that the press, for your part, has proved itself otherwise, or do you not bear them any ill will?
It depends, you know. I think I try to look at it with a bit of humour and just think, OK, I wait to see what they're going to say, you know.
But we're talking about a group of people, the press, who camped outside your house one Christmas and told your mother that they were waiting for you to die.
Yeah, I know. It's, well, I think, you know, it's all down to money, really. If it's that important to them to get their £25 for the story or their picture.
Did it surprise you that there was a time when, talking about checkbook journalism, that there was a contract out on you that anybody could have made from Fleet Street thousands of pounds to tell a story about you?
But it does let you know who your friends are. So in a lot of ways, it really cleaned up my phone book. You know.
That is called positive thinking, George.
Yeah, you just think, OK, I've forgiven some people, because I know that I've, underneath they're quite decent people, but a lot of people, in particular, Marilyn... I mean, as I said earlier, I don't know where he is and I don't particularly care, but I think, you know, there's certain people that I kind of... If they do give me their number again, I write it in pencil. Yeah.
Let's pause for the fourth record.
Well, as I said earlier, this is one of my heroes when I was a teenager. This is Mark Bolan. I think this is a brilliant song. It's really simple. It's to the point. Life's a guess.
I've loved you good like a planet. I could have changed your heart to a star. But it really doesn't matter at all. No, it really doesn't matter at all. Life's a guess.
Mark Bolan and Life's a Guess. So George, 1983, 1984, success and more success. And then suddenly it all began to go wrong. Why did it go wrong?
I don't know. Who knows? We put an album out that the critics didn't like. And I don't think we liked it either, to be quite honest with you. Because sometimes you read reviews and you think, yeah, it's quite true, really. But there's nothing much you can do about it because you've already done it. So, you know, you have to kind of, like, wait for the grenade to go off. And that's really when it started to go wrong. I mean, I think if we'd have carried on being successful, I don't know what would have happened. Who's to say? But I think, really, once we started getting bad write-ups about our music and we didn't get played on the radio, we had our first single that bombed. Radio 1 didn't play it. So it was like, what's a boy to do? A bit like that, really. I mean, I remember talking to a journalist and I said, well, what would you do if you brought a story into your editor? And he said, this is rubbish. You know, I'm going to get someone younger with a better haircut. You know, how would you feel? And I think everybody feels the same. So things just started to go wrong. It's a lot of leisure time, I think. I had lots of money. Didn't really have to do anything.
Is that why you turned to drugs?
I don't know, really. I don't know. I really can't say.
But that just suddenly happened.
I mean, if there was an answer, then I think a lot of other people wouldn't turn to drugs. If there was a clean-cut answer, then it would make life a lot simpler. But I don't think there is one, to be quite honest with you. It's impossible to say what it is.
I suppose the psychologist would say it was perhaps to do with guilt, having too much money, or guilt about your sex life, which was less than orthodox.
Oh, I've
deep
never been,
Irish
never been
Catholic
about
guilt.
That. No, I don't know about that. I mean, I don't come from a dogmatic Catholic family anyway. My parents do believe in God, you know, but I don't know if it's anything to do with Catholic guilt, because we were never brought up to be guilty, you know. In our house, you know, God was someone that was pretty nice. You turned to God when you were totally distraught. It wasn't something that was used against us.
And do you still do that?
Do I still do it? I've been through a couple of weird religious stages. I have a lot of religious things in my house. A lot of people say that there's definitely something going on, but I don't know.
What
really.
Sort of religious
I've things? Got icons, and I collect a lot of sort of statues. When I was in America, I bought a lot of sort of Jesus statues. People react differently to them. They sort of say, ugh. I mean, I don't buy any of those horrible ones with the blood or anything like that. I wouldn't have anything like that in my house. But the kind of, I don't know, I really like religious imagery. I always have. So, I mean, maybe that, you know, the psychologist probably have a field day with that as well.
Where did you find, I mean, you've beaten the drugs completely, haven't you? It's gone. That's it.
It's 2.5 years now.
Where did you find the strength from to fight it?
I don't know, really. I think so many bad things happened. And I know, I mean, one of the really the strongest images I have to this day is I'm watching the news and my mum being on the news and her face was so sad. And I thought, and that really kind of, I thought, right, okay, this is enough. And I think when I saw that, it was affecting my family. I mean, it was affecting all of my family, and all they wanted to do really was go about their business, you know.
What was your mother saying?
She wasn't saying anything. It was just like a kind of slow-motion thing on the news, you know, of her coming out of court. And I just thought, this is, you know. It's either, you know, I think there's a time in everyone's life when they're doing things, you know, whether it be alcohol, you know, overworking, anything that's an addiction, because they're all addictions. But I think, like, for instance, now I tend to do a lot of things. Like, I do relaxation classes now, and I have singing lessons now, which I never did before.
Let's have your next record.
This is by Elizabeth Welsh, and it's Stormy Weather. This is an old classic song, and it's from Derek Jarman's film The Tempest. I wanted to play this for Derek, and because it's a brilliant song and a really good choice that he put in the film, and I just love this version.
Life is bad. Gloom and misery everywhere, stormy weather, just can't get my poor self together. I'm weary all the time.
Stormy Weather, sung by Elizabeth Welch from Derek Jarman's film The Tempest. Well, George, we talked about drugs. Presumably you've also felt fear of the other great scourge of our time, which is AIDS.
Oh, no. Yeah, I do. I mean, I don't know if I do, really, actually, to be quite honest with you, because, you know, I don't know, really. I'm not very promiscuous. Never have really been. So I don't really. I mean, of course, I'm concerned about it. I'm concerned about it for everybody, not just for myself, which I think is important, because I think a lot of people take a very selfish view about it, you know, and it's like, you know, it only happens to gay people, it only happens to you know, people that take drugs. It can happen to anybody, and I think that's becoming more and more apparent. I think if I was kind of like an ordinary, I'd never like to be ordinary, but if I was like a working person and, you know, like a 9-to-5 type job, and all I did was go out looking for people to sleep with, then I think it would probably depress me a lot more. I tend to sort of think more about my work than sex. Oh, God, that's not going to be one of those quotes. I prefer good day's work to sex, says poor George.
But all of which brings us back to the question which you know you always get asked, which is you and your sexuality. Mm-hmm. I was going to say the problem of your sexuality, but your sexuality is not a problem to you, is it?
No. And I don't see why it should be a problem to anybody else, really.
Well, I think we're all confused.
But, you know, I mean, I would never dream of asking you what you did, you know.
Well, I could define myself. I could say I was a normal heterosexual female. What can you say?
I can say I'm a normal... What was that famous quote of Quentin Crisp? Are you a practicing homosexual? No, I'm perfect. I don't have to practice.
But you enjoy confusing us, don't you?
Well, I don't know if I enjoy confusing people, but I just think I don't know what I want from 1 year to the next. It changes all the time, you know. And that's not a cop-out or a sitting on the fence. I just think that, you know, you never know what you're going to be or what you're going
to
do.
You have said that you'd like to have children.
Yeah, I'd like to. But if I ever see a program on this, like, sometimes I watch, you know, I watch TV, there's a thing on the other night about adoption. I was thinking, oh, they're gorgeous, you know. But you just, I mean, I don't think I'd be allowed to, really. Although I'd make a fine parent.
Would you?
Yeah, I think I would. I think it's difficult being a parent. Obviously, it'd be easier for me because I've got more money. You know, and I can sort of probably, I don't know, probably I'd spoil them. But I would like to. I'd like to have a child.
And when you say you'd like to have a child, you mean you'd like to have one simply in that sense of maybe adopting one, or do you mean you would like to father a child?
Either. I'm not fussy. Either.
So you might become...
Whatever's easiest at the time.
Depends who's around. But you might, you never know, become really quite orthodox and get married and have children.
Well, I don't think you need to get married to have a child. Just think you have to care about it and, you know, give it some kind of stable life. That's all.
Let's have a record.
This is Ella Fitzgerald, obviously one of the greatest singers of her in the world. This is When a Woman Loves a Man.
Maybe he's not much, just another man doing what he can. But what does she care when a woman loves a man?
When a Woman Loves a Man by who else but Ella Fitzgerald. George, how do you keep body and soul together these days? You're a fitness freak, are you?
At the moment I am, yeah. It's the first time in my life when I've ever actually done exercise. I was up at 9 o'clock this morning. I have a guy that comes around to my house and we do an hour every morning. Mainly it's for relaxation. I mean, a friend of mine told me about, he does a class. I didn't want to go there. Because I don't know, I always get really embarrassed about going to places with lots of other people with similar problems. And it's been like being in a doctor's surgery, you know, so I don't like it. But I just got in touch with him. And he comes and visits me, and it's great. But he's quite strict. I mean, it's not, like, jokey or anything. If I mess around, he says, OK, you know, so that's quite good.
You're very fussy about what you eat.
Yeah.
How fussy?
Well, I have a macrobiotic. But macrobiotic is worse than vegan. My friends say it's like eating bark of tree and blade of grass. I eat all whole foods, brown rice, lentils, and lots of vegetables. Don't eat any cheese. I don't eat potatoes.
Meat?
Don't eat any meat. I eat white fish, freshwater fish.
What do you drink?
Herb teas, water, hot water, and fruit juices.
And how do you look after your mind? How do you give yourself peace of mind?
That's a difficult one. I'm still working on that. But I think basically you know, as I said before, you know, I have really good friends now. People that I think I can trust and feel that I can trust. Or even more to the point, people that I don't have to be Boy George with.
Shall we have your seventh record?
This is Woman to Woman, and this is one of those 70s records. It's very, very funny. You have to listen to it, really. It always makes me laugh, this record.
The car he drives, I pay the note every month. So I'm telling you these things to let you know how much I love that man. And woman to woman, I think you'll understand just how much I'll do to keep him. Woman to woman, if you've ever been in love, then you know how I feel.
Woman to Woman, sung by Shirley Brown. So, George, has the novelty of being Boy George and all that that entails, has the novelty worn off a bit now?
No, not at all. But it is really nice. I mean, like, for the last 2 years, particularly last year, towards the end of last year, I felt like everybody else. It was just a really nice feeling, you know, just kind of going out to clubs. And I think you kind of desensitise people if you go out all the time, because then they're like, oh, yeah, there's George, and they leave you alone. Mm. Whereas if you turn up in a big hat and, you know, swagger in, everybody's like, mm, like he's trying to get attention.
What about money? I mean, you presumably still got lots of it.
Got a bit, yeah.
Does it matter to you?
Well, it's not more important than my integrity. I mean, let me into a little scoop here. I'm currently having a big fight with my American record company. I used to be signed to CBS in America. I'm now signed to the hideous Virgin Records in America as well, which is a real disaster for me. I'm very dogmatic about things, especially with my work. For instance, you know, they do things like you'll do the most amazing photograph in colour and the American record company will decide that they'd like to put it on the cover of the record in black and white so it looks like you're not wearing any makeup. The American records in America, they're run by people. It's like everybody's trying to make the most money. It's like corporate games. And you are the least important thing. You know, the great thing about this country is that whatever happens, it's the best place to be when you're an artist. Even though you have bad times, England is much better because we allow for growth and we allow for ideas, you know. We allow people to express themselves, which they don't in America. That's why I've never gone there. My guitarist is moving there next month. I mean, I probably will go and spend some time there this year if I get my visa back, but I definitely, definitely wouldn't go live in America.
So you're at peace in this country. Where do you live? You live in London?
I live in Hampstead, yeah. It's no secret. I have loads of people outside my house all the time.
What sort of house do you live in?
It is a really beautiful house. I mean, I chose it because it's got a lot of character and it's gothic. I don't know, it looks good now. The guy who makes my clothes said it looks the best it's ever looked.
Can I ask you the classic question, really? You are George O'Dowd, born and bred in Shooter's Hill. Uh-huh. It's 7 years on and now you're sitting here being talked to about your life and talking about my guitarist, and the man who designs my clothes. You sound like a star.
I don't know if I think of myself... Yeah, I do think of myself as a star. It would be a lie to say that I didn't, because everybody, a lot of people treat me like I am. I mean, I'm not like Michael Jackson or anything like that, you know. I mean, I've met lots of famous people. You know, I still have people that I admire. I mean, I've been trying to get together with Bette Davis for the last year. She phoned me at Christmas and wished me happy Christmas. I've never met her, but I've wanted to meet her for years.
And you've sent her dozens of red roses.
I have as well. And, I mean, you know, Liz Taylor's another one I'd like to meet. And there's so many people. So, I mean, I still... I'm very much touched by it. So perhaps that's why I enjoy it, because I still look at... There are still people that I think, wow, I'd love to meet them.
But for you, being Boy George and being a star, when all is said and done, despite all of your experiences, it's actually quite a nice thing to be, a happy thing to be.
Now, I have often wondered, like, what's the point of it all? You know, you think, well, what's the point of this, you know? But, you know, I get letters from people and it really makes you think, you know, you just think, you do some stupid little thing that you think is nothing, like you write a letter to somebody. I mean, I spend a lot of time writing to people and you just do it. I mean, it could be like 2 lines or a picture. And the response you get from that is brilliant.
Your 8th record.
This one is Tom Robinson and this is called War Baby. This is just a really nice song.
Smooth skin and tenderness, long ago on a dark night. Wish I could see you once again, just to remember that it was true. I wanna be still beside you, quiet and still beside you, listening to your breathing and feeling your warmth again. Whoa, baby. You were a war baby.
Tom Robinson singing War Baby. So, George, if you could only take one of those records with you, which one would it be?
Probably be the Madness record.
It Must Be Love.
Yeah.
Why?
Because it's sort of, the arrangement of that song, I mean, it sounds really technical, the arrangement's really sort of happy, but it's quite a sad song. I remember when I used to hear it on the radio, it always made me really sad. Suggs isn't a brilliant, brilliant vocalist, but he's got so much character, and it just seems like he works really hard.
And a book, you've got the complete works of Shakespeare and you've got the Bible. Why do you laugh? You might want to read them.
I shouldn't think I would.
What would you like to take as well as those?
I'd probably take a photo album. One of my photo albums from, like, 1979, around that period. So I used to collect a lot of photos, and I got some brilliant photos. I'd probably take one of those, just because I always like to feel that I'm in contact with people, whether it be physically or spiritually or whatever, or mentally, or just in my thoughts. I definitely am one of those people that needs company, so God knows what I do on a desert island. Be a totally distressing experience for me, I think.
And you're allowed a luxury. What would you like to take for that?
I'd take a radio.
Why?
Because then I think I'd have that illusion that there were people. I'd turn it up really loud and leave it over one side of the island so it'd sound like there were people.
All right, you can have a radio. Boy George, George O'Dowd. Boy, as they call you in America. Boy, thank you very much for letting us hear your desert island disc.
Cheers.
Thank you.